Hey, good morning, CrossPoint. Let's go ahead and stand on our feet. Y'all, it's going to be a good day. I'm going to tell you that right now. Let's sing it out.
Oh, come let us worship our King. Come let us bow at His feet. He has done great things.
Yes, He has.
See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh,
come on.
Oh, hero of heaven, You conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Done great things. We dance in Your freedom. Awaken the lion. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great things.
Yeah.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things.
Oh, yeah.
And I know You will do it again. For Your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. Oh, God, You do great things.
Great things. Come on, let's sing that out together.
Oh, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, You have done great things.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all.
I love the second verse where it says, You've been faithful through every storm, and You'll be faithful forevermore. I was reading in Psalm 46 this morning, and it says that the Lord is our refuge, and He's our strength. And I love this. It says that He's our very present help in times of trouble. How cool is that? I mean, you could just say He's our help in times of trouble, but for me, it just very present popped off the page. We believe that this morning. We believe he is very present. And whatever we're all bringing into this place, that he's wanting to do something amazing. And so our prayer before we walked on this stage this morning was, God, you do you, and you show off. And that's our prayer this morning. As we come together, Lord Jesus, in this place, would your glory just show off? Would you let us feel your presence? It's in Jesus' name.
Strangers, neighbors, our blood is one. Children of generations, of every nation, of kingdom come.
Believe this.
Don't let your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high. Don't fear no evil. Fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where I am comes from.
Sing his name together.
Jesus, our redemption, our salvation is in his blood. Oh, yes, it is. Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, his kingdom come. So don't let your
together, let's swing wide these doors. Come on, every voice, come on, let's go. Swing wide,
swing wide, all you heavens, let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Always sing that again. Sweet wine, all you heavens, let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All the children, clean hands, pure grace, good grace, good God. His kingdom come. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. 'Cause I'm no longer a slave, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. Oh, yes, it has. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. 'Cause I'm no longer a slave. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child.
Jesus, I'm so thankful that that we are not a slave to fear. Fear will not hold the last word in our lives. We're not stuck, and we are not hopeless. And we find our hope in you, Jesus. You call us sons and daughters, and you protect us like a father. You walk with us like a father. You nurture us like a father. And not necessarily the example of Father that we've seen, but the perfect expression of what that is. So we receive that label that you give us, sons, daughters, your children. And with that, we walk in hope and we pursue hope and we believe that you'll have the last word. So will you have the last word today, Jesus? We pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. All right, you guys can have a seat. Good morning. Welcome to CrossPoint. My name's Chris. I'm one of the pastors here. I am so excited that all of you are with us today. There are still plenty of seats. I know there's still people coming in. Come on in and find a spot. You couldn't have chosen a better day to be here at CrossPoint. I want to welcome you if you're watching online as well. We're glad you're with us. You're part of our church family, and you get to be a part of a really special day. Today's Baptism Sunday. If you've been here for a while, you understand why we get excited about Baptism Sunday. It's just one of the most beautiful, celebratory, emotional services that we have, and so glad that you're a part of it with us. Now, you know, on Baptism Sunday, I should mention this. There's probably some of you who didn't realize today was Baptism Sunday. Maybe that's something you've thought about doing and wondered when the next one was, or maybe even just in these last few days, you've been feeling that nudge. What I want to tell you is that you can still choose to be baptized today, that we have prepared for you. We've done everything we could think of to make it comfortable for you to be baptized today. We have a change of clothes for you. We've got towels and hair dryers, makeup, probably some other things people thought of that I didn't. And all you have to have is the courage to take the step. And you'll have that opportunity later in the service. We'll give you more details. I just wanted to tell you that now. Now, I've been a part of CrossPoint for a long time. When my wife and I first came to this church, we had a one-year-old daughter, and it was the first time in my life that I ever chose a church with the kids program in mind. You know, prior to that, I had always just looked for a church for meeting my needs and for my preferences. But it was different for us when we came to CrossPoint. With the one-year-old, we wanted to make sure we chose a church that was going to be great for her and later her sister. And we wanted a church that was going to partner with us to help us raise our kids for Jesus. And my kids have literally grown up in this church. I know that's true for a lot of you as well. And here's what we know to be true. Kids ministry will never pay for itself. Students will never pay for their own ministry. They'll never buy their own pizza. And we have the opportunity to do that for them, to tell them that we value them and their future enough to invest in them. And when you give here, whether you have kids or not, I want to tell you that you're investing in the next generation. I want to say thank you, and I want to give you an opportunity to be a part of that. So I'm going to invite the greeters to come forward as we receive our offering today. And there are multiple ways you can give if you want to be a part of this, not just the buckets that are passing by, but also there's kiosks in the lobby. And of course, a lot of us just give online because that's nice and easy. As y'all do that, I'm going to invite Gina McLean, who's our next generation pastor, to come up and join with me. Gina leads our initiatives from babies all the way to college students that she's leading the charge. Hi, Gina.
How are you?
Someone in your family cheered for you.
I heard that. Thank you for that.
We'll get a more thorough ovation as this goes.
That's right.
Yeah,
all right. I got people out here
this.
And love me.
It's a hot crowd. Hey, so Gina, obviously there's a lot we do on a weekly basis to invest in kids and students, but I know during the summer we dial it up quite a bit.
Yeah, we do.
What do we do for kids?
We get a little crazy in the summer. You see, for kids we have this experience that we call Big Gross Adventure. And Chris, just for you, because I know sometimes it's harder for you to catch on to things, I'm going to break that
That's
down
true.
For you. What is Big Gross Adventure?
Yeah.
It's big, it's gross, and it's an adventure.
Okay, see, now I get it.
See?
See,
now
that's
we're
what
all
I've been
on the
missing
same page.
Before.
All right, so now that Chris has caught up with the rest of us. Yeah, that's our big summer experience for our elementary age students. And so it's 3 days where you get to come, or your kids get to come, and they just get to have some fun. And in the process, they get to learn more about their relationship with Jesus. They get to bring their friends as well. And it's free, which fits really well in my budget.
Yeah, absolutely. It's the perfect price. I've always said that. That's well documented. Now, we don't just in the summer do extra things for kids. For our teenagers as well, we go the extra mile. So what are we doing for teenagers this
year? We're going a lot of extra miles
this year.
This year, we're actually taking them to the beach.
Yeah. Excellent. Hey, we can all go.
Yeah. It's crazy how well you can recruit people for serving in student ministry when you decide to take students to the beach, right? But yes, we are taking all of our students to the beach this year. It's going to be 4 days where they get to dive deeper into learning more about their relationship with their Heavenly Father, 4 days of diving deeper into friendships with their peers. And really, it's a great setup for their next year of school as we lead into the fall.
Yeah.
And it's at the beach,
yeah,
right?
I've always said the only thing better than taking your kids to the beach is someone else taking your kids to the beach. And so
that's what we're going to do.
Yeah, well, that's excellent. Well, you were all handed a card as you walked in. It has the information you need, both about Big Gross Adventure and student camp. And if you don't have kids, I bet there might be someone that you work with or maybe in your family that does. Pass the word on. We want to reach as many students and kids as possible with the hope of Jesus. So we all give Gina a hand. Thank you, Gina. Thanks for coming up. I'm so excited for all that's going on in the lives of our kids and students, and we'll continue to share stories of what God is doing in those ministries that we don't always get to see, but He's clearly at work. And we believe God is at work in our city. We're in a series right now called Awaken, where we've been praying and fasting, not just for what God would do in our life for the breakthrough that we're looking for, but for the breakthrough that we want to see in our city. And it's been an incredible series with a lot of stories. We get to continue that today as Pastor Kevin shares with us. So welcome to Awaken.
There's an uncommon unity that is in this city. We say more of that, God, more unity among the churches, because when Jesus looks at the church of Nashville, He sees His church.
Welcome to CrossPoint in week three of Awaken, and I want to begin with a story. I've got, this is Ree's, my wife Ree. This is her wedding band, and it's not. So let me tell you how that came to be. We met when we were in eighth grade. I was smitten. She was not. And so I kept pursuing. It took me 4 years to get out of the friend zone, and I ended up dating her when we got to college. We dated all the way through college. We were engaged for a year after we graduated from college, and we set our wedding date as July 29th, year 2000, which is an incredible year to get married, because you always know, like, how many years you've been married by what year it is. And so, like, we had that set, like, as our watershed moment of our relationship, when we would say, I do. And it's on the calendar. It's 4 o'clock. It's noon on July 29th, and I was getting ready. All the groomsmen were at the house, and we were all getting ready. And we were getting ready to leave. And I went to grab her ring, which was in a little box. And I opened up the box before we left. I opened up the box just to look, and it wasn't in the box. This is not a good moment. You get married in 4 hours and can't find the ring. And so I thought, surely, like, one of the groomsmen was playing a joke on me. So I kind of put the word out, hey, if you got the ring and you're playing a joke, it's not funny, give me the ring. And they weren't threatened because nobody admitted to taking the ring. So then I'm like, okay, we all got to look. So we turn the house upside down looking for the ring. We can't find the ring. We look for 30 minutes, and I'm thinking, we got to leave. And so I figure, I know what I'll do. I'll call my wife. I'll call my bride. We're not married yet. And so I was going, I'm gonna call her, and I'm going to let her know, because that's what married people do. They tell each other stuff. So this would be good. I'll let her know that I can't find her ring. That'd be good. Just confess that. For some reason, I thought that'd be a good idea. It was not a good idea. For some reason, that's not what the bride-to-be wants to hear when she's putting on her mascara for her wedding, is that he can't find the ring. And so at that moment, like, that conversation didn't go so well. And so I'm like, man, we gotta solve this problem. So on the way to the church, we stopped by Walmart, and we bought a ring, hoping it was the right size, for $30. And so that's what this is. This is the Walmart wedding band. And my wife, like, she is so gracious, and she is so kind, because she just smiled at me. I don't know what she mumbled under her breath when I put that ring on her finger, but she was smiling. And she was. She was so kind in that moment. And listen, we laughed. Like, on our honeymoon, we laughed when we got the call that they had found the ring. And some of you are wondering, well, where was the ring? My brother, who was my best man, I mean, he's still, like, my best man, but, like, he was showing it to my sister-in-law after the rehearsal dinner, and when he was showing it to her, he opened the box, and when he was putting it back down, it fell out. And so it fell out, and, like, he had one job. Like, that's it. Like, just the ring, bro. And, you know, we laughed, and it's funny, we're laughing now. Like, and we laughed on our honeymoon, but we weren't laughing then. Because very few people have their worst moment on the best day of their life. But we all have the experience of losing something, don't we? We all have the experience of losing something that matters, even God himself. In fact, when you read through the Bible, you get into Genesis, and it tells us the story of Adam and Eve, and they sinned, meaning they drifted from God. They turned from God, and they went their own way. And God asked the question. He asked a question as he's pursuing them. He says, "Where are you?" Now, God wasn't confused. He knew exactly where they were on the map. But that question, "Where are you?" was a question of what happened to the relationship. Where are you in your soul? Like, we're not connected like we used to be. And so in Luke chapter 19, Jesus said, "The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which is lost." In other words, what Jesus is saying is, I'm on an all-out search and rescue mission for those who have lost their way. I am pursuing those who have lost their way in life. And this is important because we all have lost our way. We all can lose our way at life. And Jesus uses that word lost, and that word got hijacked by some religious people who use that term as a negative term, as a derogatory term for unbelievers. But for Jesus, it was never a derogatory term. It was a term of endearment. And what he was saying is these are people that are precious to me, that I love, that I'm pursuing, that I'm going after. And because in order for something to be lost, as we talked about last week, it must first be valued. But I'll tell you what I learned from this wedding band. What I learned from this ring, and if you're taking notes, you can write it down. The more you value something, the more intensely you search. There is a correlation between how much you value something and your pursuit or your search or the way that you look for it. The intensity of the search gets ratcheted up when you're valuing greatly the thing that is lost or the thing that's misplaced. And when you understand the value of something, you just look with a little bit more intensity. I heard a story about a teenager she had lost her contact lens, and so she's looking all over for a contact lens. She's searching for it, looking for it. She's looking for a long time. Finally, she calls for her mom. She said, "Mom, can you come help me find my contact lens?" Mom comes in like 30 seconds, mom finds it. Don't you love how mom can do that? Moms just have a way, and the daughter's like, "I was looking forever, and I couldn't find it. What happened?" And mom said, "Well, you were looking for your lost contact lens. I was looking, thinking about the $100 it was going to cost to replace it." And when you understand the value of something, you look with a higher intensity. And now, here's the thing. You don't have to tell people what you value. They can just tell by the way that you're living. See, you don't have to say, "This is what I value." People can tell what you value by looking at your Instagram posts, by watching what you tweet. People can, by listening to what you talk about, by seeing the way you spend your money. See, our lives reflect what we value. And here's how we get lost in our own lives. When our value system gets off. When our values get out of order, that's when we can get lost in our own lives. When we value career success more than our spouse and our kids, we can get lost in our own lives. When we value what other people think more than what God thinks, when we value building a brand more than building a soul, when we value what is temporary over what is eternal, when our values get off, we can get lost in our own lives. This is why Jesus said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." What he's saying is, what's the kingdom of God? That is God and his activity in the earth. And what Jesus is saying, if you seek first God and his activity in the earth, all the other things will find their place. But the order of values matter. He says, "Seek first God." In other words, look for God like you would your car keys, because you're not getting anywhere without him. And all these things will be added to you. I mean, he's going to take care of the other things if we put all the other values fall into place when we put him first. But when our values get out of line, when we stop valuing God, here's what happens. We lose sight of our value. The person you see in the mirror every day, you lose sight of your value, and we diminish the value of other people. We don't see the value that other people have. And this is what had happened in Jesus' day. Because the people had gotten so wrapped up in the political environment of the day and the religious system of the day that they stopped valuing people who were different than them. Aren't you glad we've evolved 2,000 years later and that we're different in our society? So what happened? Well, in that day, the political system was Rome. And Rome the Roman Empire, they were oppressive in their rule, and they are trying to squeeze the life out of the conquered territory of Israel, and they're doing it through taxes. People were taxed, people in poverty were taxed 50% on their income. And they did that through tax collectors, through people who were from that local territory who signed on to help collect these taxes. And basically, they were betraying their own people. They were traitors. They were betraying their own people on behalf of Rome, collecting these taxes. And they were backed by the Roman army. And so these people were despised. They were hated. The religious leaders of the day said that they were beyond redemption, that they were too far gone, that there's no way that a tax collector could ever be made right with God. And so taxes were this socially and politically and religiously charged issue. And this is the issue that the religious leaders used to try to trap Jesus. Now, look with me at, we're going to look at Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22 in the Bible. If you got one, you can turn there with me. We're going to put it up on the screen. Matthew chapter 22, verse 15. It says, then the Pharisees, and these were the religious leaders, the Pharisees went out and they laid plans to trap him, meaning Jesus, in his words. And they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. Teacher, they said, we know that you're a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by others because you pay no attention to who they are. Stop right there. Can you smell the insincerity? Like Jesus smells it. Jesus sees what they're doing. They're coming and they're just pouring it on. They're trying to set him up because they're trying to trap him. And this says, then tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay the imperial tax to Caesar or not? Here's what's going on. Here's why it's a trap. Because if Jesus says you should pay your taxes to Rome, if he says yes, then the people who hate Rome are going to hate him. Now, if he says no, Jesus knows that Rome's going to come and get him. Because there was a guy around the time of Christ when Jesus was a boy named Judas of Galilee. He led a revolt against Rome and said, hey, we're going to lead a revolt. Don't pay your taxes. They crucified 2,000 people that were a part of that movement. And Rome left, they left the crosses up along the main road to be a reminder to people to pay your taxes. And so this is the environment. This is what's going on. And so how is Jesus going to answer this question? This is genius. Look at verse 18. But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, he said, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax. And they brought him a denarius. Now, I actually have a coin from the Roman Empire, from Tiberius Caesar, from the time of Christ. This would have been the type of coin. I mean, you would think maybe something like this would be on loan from Frist, you know. And so we've got this coin, right? Now, on this coin, just kind of tell you what it says because I don't read Latin, but let me tell you what it says. It says, Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine Augustus. Essentially that Tiberius is the son of Augustus. That he's the son of God. He is the divine son. So on one side, there would be this image of Caesar in the statement that he is the son of God. Now, Jesus said, who's on the coin? And they said, Caesar. And he says, unto Caesar, what is Caesar's? But then he says, unto God, what is God's? In other words, whose image is on you? And they would understand, God's. But Jesus said, God's image is on you, then give what is God's back to him. See, you need to know your life like this coin. This coin's been stamped with the image of a king. You've been stamped with the image of a king. That when God made mankind, when he made man and woman, he made man and woman in his own image, which means you reflect a glory that is greater than you. You reflect the glory of God, the dignity he's put on you, the value that he's placed on you, the wonder that he's placed on you. And there is this value that's been given to you. And just like the other side has the value, the other side of the coin has a value, you wonder, what are you worth? You need to know you're worth Jesus to God. He gave his own son out of his love for you. And that value has been placed in you. That value is woven into you by the creator of the universe. And so you may struggle with your worth. And when you want to know your worth, you go to the cross. You look at Jesus because you're worth Jesus to God. Your life is sacred, and every human life is a life of worth and value to him. You've been made in the image of God, and other people too. And in Jesus' day, he didn't clamor and chased down the sophisticated. He pursued the marginalized and the oppressed. Why? Because the people who questioned their value, he wanted them to know that they matter to God. And here was this one time he took the disciples on a short-term mission trip to Samaria. And when they got to Samaria, he posted up at this well, and he was sitting there at the well, and this woman came up to the well. And disciples went off. They went off to Crystal to get some sandwiches, and they were out getting lunch, and Jesus is having a conversation with this lady, and she had been married 5 times. And to the woman who had been in 5 broken marriages, Jesus looked at, and a woman who had been ostracized from her society and went to the well at noon when nobody else would be there, Jesus is like, I've been looking all over for you. He went out of his way to Samaria to find her and to tell her that he would give her true life if she would put her faith in him. And Jesus has a way. He chases down. He pursues the sick, the leper, the blind, the lame, children. They come to him. Jesus has a way of pursuing. I mean, in fact, the story that we just read in the Gospel of Matthew, you know what Matthew's job was before he was a disciple? He was a tax collector. And so Jesus is inviting to his inner circle the people who the religious system had pushed away. And maybe people have pushed you away and you've thought that that's the way God feels about you. But you need to know that Jesus invites you as close as you want to come. He invites you to his table. And just like he invited Matthew to follow him, he invites you to follow him as well. In fact, this was driving the religious leaders crazy of the day. In fact, we looked at these two verses in Luke chapter 15. It tells us about what's going on. It says, now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Like, I don't know what muttering sounds like, but this man welcomes sinners. That sounds kind of like Inigo Montoya, but like, you kill my father, prepare to die. But there's this, I don't know. But there's this drawing of Jesus for people who are nothing like him. They're drawn to him in a diverse audience. And you've got religious people and irreligious people. You've got people who have all the answers. And you've got people who've got nothing but questions. You've got people who had the entire, Torah memorized. And you've got people who know nothing of it. And just like today, we've got all across the spectrum a diverse group. And what Jesus would say is that everyone needs to be awake to the love of God. That everyone needs to know their value to God. And God's love, that God is madly in love with you. And Jesus came to communicate that truth. In fact, he did it through stories. And when I tell my kids stories, I usually do it to put them to sleep. But Jesus told us stories to wake us up. And that wasn't the only time that Jesus used the coin as an illustration. There was an... That's not good. All right, we'll just keep going. Now here's the deal. If that coin was worth like hundreds of thousands of dollars and I didn't look for it, like you would either question my sanity or you would question the value of the coin or you would question my job. Like all those things would be, and here it is right here. This is not on loan from Frist. I bought it on eBay a couple years back, but like, but you can tell the value of something by the intensity of the search. And here's what you need to know, is that Jesus has been pursuing you. He is not casual in his pursuit of you. The Spirit of God has been working in your life. God's been pursuing you since the day you were born. He's been seeking after you. And he's not casual. In fact, Jesus laid his life down for you. That's how intense his pursuit is. And so when Jesus tells this story, he communicates that truth. Go to verse 8. It says, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. So we read the story. We got this woman, and she's looking like mad. She's searching all over. She's got the lamp. She's shining the light. She's sweeping through the house, and she's looking. She's on her knees. She's looking for this coin, trying to find it. Why the intensity of the search? What more is going on here? Let me tell you. When the people in that day heard 10 coins, they knew exactly what Jesus was talking about. He was talking about the dowry. He was talking about the 10 coins that would be a part of the dowry process, that when a woman was married, as part of the dowry, she would receive 10 coins that have been passed down from generation to generation to generation that she would wear in a headdress that would be a symbol of the covenant, and to lose one of those coins would be the equivalent of losing your wedding band on your wedding day. Like, it was a big deal. And so she's looking all over that because it would be a disgrace for her to have 9 coins when she should have 10 coins. And so she's looking like mad. And what Jesus wants us to know about the heart of God, that the heart of God is not at rest when those who are to be with him have wandered and far from him. That God will not give up pursuit, and that he searches with the light of the truth that he reveals, and the Holy Spirit sweeps through and is moving in your life to draw you to let you know that he is looking, he's looking for you. And some of you feel more like a coin right now than you ever have in your life, because you feel more misplaced right now than you ever have in your life. And maybe you've moved from job to job, and you've moved from relationship to relationship, and you've moved from city to city trying to find your place and trying to find your people, and you've been searching, and you've been going to entertainment and achievement and accomplishment and self-medication. You've been going to all the things to try to fill this place in here, but you need to know that there is nothing that will fill this place in here aside from finding your place in the heart of God. And God invites you to himself, and he's in pursuit of you. And you'll never, and you can search your whole life, but you'll never find your place on the planet until you find your place in the heart of God. And God's like, you don't have to go anymore. You don't have to wander anymore. But the beautiful part of the story is, what did the coin have to do to be found? Absolutely nothing. Like, the coin, what was he going to do? That's my coin face. I don't know. That's like, what's the coin going to do? He's a, hey, I mean, the coin can't make a sound. The coin can't do anything. And you need to, what do you need to do to be saved? Nothing. There's nothing you can do. It's by grace. It's a gift of God. You don't earn it. You receive it. And this is why we're participating in Awaken Nashville. This is why we're fasting and praying, because we want to see the city. We want to see people. We want to see our friends and our neighbors, our coworkers. We want to see people across the city awake to the love of God. And why are we fasting? Because we need to be awakened too. Because as followers of Jesus, we can fall asleep to our own value, and we can fall asleep to the value of God, and that God values people more than anything. And that we would participate in the business of heaven and what all of heaven is leaning toward. I mean, remember the story? I mean, this is a celebration that takes place. Verse 9, it says, and when she finds it, she calls her friends and her neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I found my lost coin. And in the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angel of God over one sinner who repents. Jesus tells us that when one person gets right with God, that the angels celebrate, that you can affect the environment and the atmosphere of heaven by the decisions that you make. And when you help somebody find Jesus, heaven celebrates that what we're praying for is a big deal to heaven. And the reason we fast and pray is because it needs to be a big deal to us. And we're saying, God, would you give me your heart for people? I love it. Jesus said, she sends out an invite and she invites everybody that's in her contact list. And she says, come to the party. Like, let's rejoice. Let's celebrate. And that's why we love Baptism Sunday. Because on Baptism Sunday, we celebrate that people have made a decision to follow Christ. And some of the people that are baptized, going to be baptized today, some of them made a decision when they were young. Some of them, they were baptized when they were infants, but today they're making a decision as an adult. Some people, they've made a decision for Christ over the past few months, some past few weeks. But today they're going public with that. Now, baptism, the act of baptism, is not what brings about salvation. It's an outward picture of what's happened in their hearts. It's a symbol of that decision, like a wedding band. Oh, this is not, like a wedding band. This is a symbol of the covenant. This is a picture of the vows that I took. It's a symbol, it's a reminder of that. Now, if you put on this wedding band, it's not gonna mean that you're married to Ray, to my wife. I mean, it'd just be weird if you put it on. But like, when I put it on, it's a symbol that I made that decision. And so when you're baptized in that way, it's a way to let other people know, I'm a follower of Christ. And maybe you've never been baptized before. Well, today can be that day for you. Somebody asked me one time, can you be a Christian and not be baptized? Which I think is an interesting question. But the question I would ask, and the question I don't answer that question, yes, because your salvation doesn't come from baptism. But the question I would have is like, but it's an opportunity, an invitation. Jesus himself was baptized. Like, do you want to just do you want to kind of skip over the first thing that he asked you to do? And maybe this is something that's been moving in your heart. And listen, this is not the press of man. If God's moving in your heart, it's the press of God. And I wouldn't want to, listen, the lady in the story, she could have easily taken that coin and just put it up in her headdress and like acted like nothing happened and not told anybody. She would have kept her pride, but she would have missed the party. It's possible to kind of hold on to our pride. It's possible for our pride to keep us from the next step of obedience. But the truth is, man, we don't want to miss the party. And we want to celebrate with you. So if you didn't prepare for baptism today and you sense God tugging you to do that and encouraging, drawing you, then we want to celebrate with you. And this would be a significant, it's going to be a significant day as we celebrate. And listen, what we get to do as a church is we get to bring up there down here with the party. The angels are celebrating, heaven's partying, heaven's celebrating, and we want to be about what heaven is about. Now, it's not the press of man, but if God is moving in your heart, don't let anything hold you back from the yes and the celebration today. There'll be people who are baptized today, and one of them has been Stephen. Let me share a story with you I received. Stephen, this week, heard about him. He's a college student who said he grew up in a religious family, but there wasn't a whole lot of conversation about Jesus. And then a friend named Kevin invited him to, which is a great name, a friend named Kevin invited him to CrossPoint. And then there was, he met Meg, and Meg kind of invited him. And over the past couple semesters, he's been coming around, and he wasn't here last weekend, and so he watched the YouTube message on Tuesday, and at the end of the message, he gave his heart to Jesus. I love it, just watching YouTube, right? But he heard the message, and this is what he said. He said, I never fully understood the value that Jesus sees in the lost. He understood he's valued. He said, I want to be found. And so he prayed to receive Christ there as he was watching that. And then he, we thought today, he said, you know, I want to be baptized. And it only seemed right that he would be the first baptism that we've shown. He said he wanted to be baptized. I thought, wouldn't it be great as we're talking about celebration that kind of lead the way in the celebration? We invited Kevin and we invited Jill and we invited Meg, some people who were instrumental in his faith story, to be there to kind of have a front row in the celebration today. So I wanted you to get a chance to see Stephen's baptism.
Man, we're excited for you. I'm so proud of you. And so we're about to baptize you. But as we do, everyone all across all our campuses, we love for you guys to just make as much noise as possible and celebrate this moment with Stephen. Stephen, do you believe Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of your life?
Yes.
Do you believe he died on the cross and forgiven you of all your sins?
Yes.
Because of that profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Celebrate, and we celebrate with heaven, and today we're going to have an opportunity to celebrate. So when somebody's baptized, in just a moment we're going to, in fact, I'd ask that you go ahead and stand with me. All of our campuses, go ahead and stand with me right now, if you can. And in a moment we're going to have a chance to worship, to sing songs, but part of our worship today, part of bringing up there, down here, is for us to celebrate each person who's made a decision to follow Jesus. And if you've made that decision, you haven't been baptized, you can be baptized today. But each one, Jesus said, they get a party in heaven. And so we want to party and rejoice with the angels. But I want to lead you into a moment of prayer, because I realize there's some that you haven't made the decision yet that Stephen made when he was watching YouTube. And so I want to give you that opportunity. So would you bow your head and your heart with me? Father, it is a wonderful thing to know that we've been found. It is a wonderful thing to know that we are loved, that we are treasured, and that you have pursued us. So thank you for that truth. And Father, I pray for those that today is the day where they say yes to you. Would you give them the courage to pray a prayer like this, and the faith they need to pray a prayer like this? If that's you, if you want to know his forgiveness and his freedom, just pray something like this. Say, Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. Right now, I give you my life. I surrender my life to you. I want to walk with you here on earth and live with you forever in heaven. Thank you for saving me. Father, thank you for those who made that their prayer for the first time. And we celebrate with the angels. Then God, I pray that you would give courage, a fresh deposit of courage in this room, in this time. God, for those who needed to take this next step, I pray that you would give them the courage that they need. And I pray that nothing would be able to hold us back from following you and being public with the work that you've done on the inside. At the same time, God, would you help our hearts feel and know what you feel over each person who's baptized today? And that when we celebrate, as we sing, and when we cheer, it would be our act of worship. Praying up there, come down here. Awaken us, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Now, if you all remain standing, we're going to move into a time of worship and baptism. And maybe there are some of you who didn't know it when you woke up this morning, but today is your baptism day. If that's you, like I said earlier, we have prepared for you. We've got a change of clothes and towels, all those things. All you would have to have is the courage to leave your seat where you are and head back to the purple light that's going to illuminate back here at this exit. We've got volunteers who are there ready to receive you and guide you through the whole process. Make it as comfortable as possible for you. You're welcome to do that now if you like. The rest of us, we're not just spectators in this. We get to be active participants. So it's going to be a time of worship, and so I want you to worship, to engage, to sing, to fully engage your hearts in this moment. But when someone comes up out of the water, I want you to celebrate like crazy the faithfulness of a God who has pursued them and found them, has saved them, and for the change that is represented in their life, what Jesus has done. We all have the opportunity to do that. So with that, I want to invite you to join us for a time of worship and baptism.
No choice but to break. Shame has no choice but to leave in your presence. Fear has no choice but to bow. Chains have no choice but to break. Shame has no choice but to leave in your presence. Fear has no choice but to bow.
have no choice but to pay. Shane has no choice but to leave. In your presence, fear has no choice but to bow. Chains have no choice but to break. Shane has no choice but to leave.
Beginning, can control what tomorrow will bring, but I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. We'll be right back.
just once more, can we celebrate all those who had the courage to be baptized today? I hope we never take it for granted. It never gets old that the celebration is never forced. That as we see God do authentic works in the lives of people, hearts changed, lives changed, eternity secured, entire families brought together in the power of Jesus, that it'll lead us to celebrate. It'll lead us to share stories, and it'll lead us to walk in a hope that none of us are stuck and no one in our life is stuck, that Jesus' transforming power is available to all. Maybe there's some of you who, over the course of that, felt that nudge, but just didn't leave and join just for a variety of reasons, or maybe feel like you missed it. I just want to tell you, we got 3 more church services, so it's not too late if you want to be a part of that. For all the rest of you, thank you for being here. Thank you for being a part of it. I hope you all have an amazing week. We'll see you next Sunday.